Robert, there's a lot going on in semiconductor at the moment. We just heard about the 5-nanometer transition for Apple from TSMC, and Samsung is also starting to supply 5-nanometer. Plans for 3-nanometer, 2, even heard 1.4-nanometer, seriously on the roadmaps now. What's the technology that's enabling all of this change?
Very exciting answer, Andy. This is all based on tin.
Tin.
Chemical element tin. And a tin plasma is the source of the light used in this lithography application. The tin plasma is generated using LPP, laser-produced plasma. So this happens in a chamber in which tiny tin droplets, molten tin droplets, are being injected at a very rapid clip. And they are hit by lasers that first flatten droplets into pancake-like shapes, and a second laser beam that then creates the actual tin plasma. Tin atoms get ionized. You strip up to 13 electrons off each tin atom. And then the electronic transitions that create the plasma spectrum create a shape that's roughly centered around 13.5 nanometers. That's what you want. And so the conversion efficiency that tin offers for this wavelength window is simply the highest of all the known elements, which is why the industry adopted this tin plasma solution as the light source for these nodes that you mentioned.
And the optics around this are incredibly complex, and the surface of them is obviously extremely important.
Mm-hmm. That's right. They're multi-layer coated. It's very difficult to treat wavelengths around 5 nanometers. We're talking soft X-rays here, as you know, and there is a very limited technology that really can handle that. So you're talking about the LPP chamber containing a spherical mirror that projects this 5-nanometer light forward towards the mask, and it being projected onto the wafer with the help of several lens optical elements. But in the chamber itself, where the tin plasma exists in these microsecond kind of flashes, you of course get a lot of debris. Which is, interestingly enough, the reason why they chose this droplet scheme to limit the mass of tin that ends up being over the walls of the chamber, and that you then need to clean up, which is the reason that gets us towards high purity tin.
And I understand the high purity tin actually changes the nature of the crystal structure. So it's that that enables the cleaning, and the fast cleaning, I understand, is the most important point here.
That's exactly right. Tin happens to have two different allotropes. And for cleaning up, you want the alpha tin that is more brittle and much easier to clean off surfaces. Therefore, you want to favor whatever helps you to get to this alpha phase. And it turns out, interestingly enough, the key driver of facilitating that is the purity grade of the tin. And this is why 5-9s and 6-9s tin is really needed in this application.
So not just the spectral purity of the emission from the tin 13 plus ion, I guess, but also the ability simply to clean it off the surfaces is very important.
That's exactly right. There's two purities involved here. You of course want a pure enough tin species that gets you to the spectral purity. You don't want any transition from other foreign elements. But it turns out you can't just use the 4-9s tin grade. That's common in the industry, that's commonly called high purity tin. You need to go beyond that. You need to go towards 5-9s and 6-9s of purity in tin. And at Indium Corporation, we have developed a process that is delivering 5-9s tin in large quantities, and we're working ourselves towards having suitable quantities available at the 6-9 purity grade. by mid next year.
So in somewhere between 6 to 8 months, we should have a 6 nines availability. And I understand there's also a roadmap as needed to 7 nines. Some couple of years later.
Yes. We have small amounts of 6.9 material available now, and sufficient amount by about mid next year, 2021.
Robert, that's absolutely fascinating. Thank you very much indeed,
Pleasure.
As always, for your time.
Thank you, Andy.